Had a client request for some analysis on TLRY. This is one of those things where you can have trade setups, but the trades that you take will have not been done before and they will not be repeated in the future because this is such a unique event that, you know, you can't backtest for this. You just have to have a decent understanding of how option markets play out and the supply and demand dynamics of kind of what's going on, okay? So TLRY is, it is a pharmaceutical company and it is a pot stock, okay? And it IPO'd in July at about 20 bucks and it's currently trading at 154. It's currently trading 168 in the overnight session. The current market cap of this stock is greater than Chipotle. And let me see if I can find some others. So Charlie Biello on Twitter has been putting out some comparisons. Okay, here we go. TLRY has a market cap above Wynn Resorts. It has a market cap above MGM. Let's see. 15 billion in market cap. That's just pretty impressive. I'm trying to find the other one that I was looking at. Okay, so yes, if TLRY were to see the continued rate of change like it has experienced during the past month and a half, it would be, I'm not going to say impossible, but it's impossible. All right, the market capitalization is not going to approach levels like Amazon. Right, so we know that by share price alone, we can look at the shares outstanding and the share price and say, what's the market capitalization of the company and what are the current market caps of, let's just say, Boeing, right? And then we can ask ourselves, does this pass the sniff test? Does TLRY, does it make sense for the current valuation of the company to be at this level? And we can be real stupid about this. We can just run comps. All right. So one way, you know, we can say Boeing or things like that. But another way to do it is just we'll hop over to FinViz and we're going to go to healthcare. And all we're going to do is sort by market cap. Okay. So we can say, all right, here are the biggest healthcare companies in domestic markets. All right. So, for example, Johnson & Johnson has a market cap of 378. So it would be reasonable to assume that this stock will not reach levels that we see in Johnson & Johnson and Pfizer and so on. Okay. Now we can start going down the list and say, all right, TLRY is currently at a market cap of around 17 billion. So where does that rank us? Right around here. So you're saying that Teva is almost worth as much as TLRY. Okay, here's TLRY. It's number 56 on the list right now in terms of market cap. So that doesn't pass the sniff test. On top of that, all right, just think about this. Simple math. Let's just start with September. All right, so August 31st, the stock was trading at $59. So it's 3x'd, give or take. It's about 300% above that level. If we were to go another 300%, from these levels, then TLRY would have a market cap of 45 billion. And then we would say, does this pass the sniff test? 45 billion is Vertex. All right. Boston Scientific's only at 50, or is at 52, not only, but that would be close. Okay. So we can assume that at some point, the rate of change will start to slow down, and most likely we will see a hard correction in this stock. Okay? Now, there's a couple different ways that this can go. The first thing, and this, you know, because we're dealing with unique situations, using analogs can only take us so far. But a good example of what we're seeing here, and just in terms of market structure, was Calabios. All right, so this is KBIO. Let me see if I can open the image. And I think KBIO has been delisted, so we can't actually see it. But KBIO is a sketchy chart, but it basically ran from about 30 cents to $45 over the course of a few weeks. And there wasn't really a significant change in the fundamentals of the stock. It's simply that there were a lot of people trying to short the stock, and there were not many shares available to short. All right, so it led to this just massive, epic short squeeze that we haven't seen before, ever, just in terms of market cap appreciation. The stock ended up getting delisted. It went bankrupt. It went under. Martin Shkreli, who was involved, he went to jail. All right, so that's one end of the spectrum. The other end of the spectrum is going to be DDRX. And this is a stock you may not have heard of, but this was about a decade ago. And it was Diedrich Coffee. Let me see if I can find a good chart of this. All right. Let's just start with this one. Of course, all the stock newsletters are like, oh yeah, we nailed DDRX while the market was crashing. And so just open up this one. Again, kind of hard to see right here. The stock ran from about 30 cents all the way up to $25, and then it kept going all the way up to about $35. Now, the difference here with DDRX versus Calabios is that DDRX got acquired. And it was because that they owned the patent to the K-Cup. And basically, you know, Green Mountain got big and, you know, Keurig's got really big. And so it was just inevitable that somebody would come and pick them up at that price level. Okay, they just had to. I think it was Pete's Coffee that ended up buying DDRX. But that's on the other side of the spectrum. Right here. What I think will most likely happen, we're continuing to see capital flows into pot stocks. We're continuing to see event-based stuff. There's news flow that Coke, you know, not cocaine, like that's a different drug, like Coca-Cola is getting involved into these kinds of stocks. Was it CGC that was involved? CGC got some money from Constellation Brands or something along those lines. So we're starting to see deal flow among major players. In terms of Tilray, again, we can go back and we can say, all right, given a market cap of $15 billion, tell me the healthcare company that's going to buy them for $15 billion. All right, who has the cash on hand or who can raise $15 billion at these price levels, assuming that they wanted to buy this particular stock? And for me, the answer is no. Okay, I don't think that there are any healthcare companies that are going to be willing to buy this stock. And it's not $15 billion right now because we've gone up 8.4%. So let's just run the math really quick. 1.08. All right, $16.25 billion. That's the current valuation of the company. All right, so we have one thing. On my side, it doesn't pass the sniff test. The stock has gone from $20 to $150, now almost $170 over the course of about, you know, a couple months. This is a parabolic move. Odds are it's not going to end well, and we're going to see aggressive drops, you know, and we'll probably eventually crack 100. My opinion on this stock, however, is a widely shared one, that there have been many investors and traders who have been trying to get the exact top on Tilray for a couple weeks now, and they have continued to fuel the fire, right? Remember, you've got buyers and sellers. Well, if you're a short seller, you're borrowing the stock and you're selling it. And if you get stopped out, you're forced to buy. And if you're forced to buy, there's more people that will buy it from you. All right. So it's one of those things where you can be right, but if your timing is garbage, then you're going to get in a lot of trouble. Now, this is a unique situation because most of the time when we see stocks run like this, they don't have options available. Like, it's completely unoptionable and everything else. On top of all that, we have HTB. All right, this is a stock that is hard to borrow. It's very difficult to find shares to short. But if you have options now, you can go out and buy the options. You can go out and buy puts, and you can short. Now think about the other side. If you're a market maker, that means you end up net long shares. And if you need to balance your deltas out, if you need to remove some directional exposure, it becomes very difficult because you don't have shares to short. Because of this, and coupled with the fact that we're seeing a parabolic spike, the implied volatility is just absolutely through the roof right now. Okay? We're setting up for a situation where normally when a stock sells off, implied volatility goes up. That's just how it goes. This will be an example of a stock selling off. Once the stock sells off, the stock now becomes easy to borrow. And if the stock is easy to borrow, then the market makers can crank down the implied volatility a little bit. And then you'll also have put sellers coming in around 80, 70, and 60 that will also drive down implied volatility. So we will see something where if the stock drops, implied volatility drops. We're going to look at some option trades. These are going to be all 100% all on your own. Because the bid-ask spread is too wide, it's very risky, it's very difficult to get executed on these trades. Just keep that in mind, okay? One other example I'd like to bring your attention to is DBX. So back in June, the stock spiked up. And the implied volatility right here, all right, so the stock was trading right around here. The implied volatility kicked up from 40% all the way to 80%. And then the stock sold off and implied volatility sold off. That's the kind of dynamic we're looking for. In fact, we took a trade in DBX around that time where we sold 1x2s because we assumed that the stock would pull back, but there would be a natural floor at the IPO base and then the implied volatility would come in. It worked out very well. So that's the kind of setup that we could be looking for. Okay. There's two trades that I think make sense here. The first one is on the open tomorrow. And look, this is hilariously aggressive. All right. Just keep that in mind. On the open tomorrow. So we closed around 156. The stock's currently trading at 168. If TLRY opens above 168, 170, go out. All right, this is just, I'm not even going to suggest it, but put buys in September with 3 days left to expiration. If you can buy the 165 put for under $15, that is a good buy. Okay? Because if TLRY pulls in, let's just say 50% of this move right here, that's 146. And if you buy the 165, that means a pull into 146, you already have $20 of intrinsic value, you've already made five. Because the implied volatility is so stupid high, you know, that's the risk. And there is also a risk that TLRY goes sideways. It's not, because these stocks don't go sideways. They either go up or they go down very aggressively. All right, so something along these lines. Analytics are kind of screwed up right now because the pricing models assume that the after hours price is the current price and things like that. But going out, and especially on this gap higher tomorrow into Wednesday, if you can buy 3 days worth of premium quickly and cheaply, I would not be surprised if this next gap up is it for the near term. And it wouldn't take much, right? If you get a gap fill, and I completely did that math wrong, buying the 165 at 15 bucks, if we see a move to 140, then that's going to be $25. I think I just did that math right. I can never do math in my head while I'm talking. But yes, anyways, this next gap up, I think will be it, and it will be exhaustion, and you can go out and you can fade it. The problem is the bid-ask spread is so stinking wide that even if you try to do it on the open, you may not get filled, because it will be a very difficult trade and would require a lot of execution. One thing I would recommend if you do want to do this, and you got to be super aggressive, you got to be willing to lose all your money on this trade. Plug in the option contract you want to do in Active Trader, or use some sort of level 2 so you can do one-click executions. Okay, that's the super aggressive one. The second one I want to bring your attention to is to say, all right, we think we're due for a pullback, and we think we're due for implied volatility also going lower. So here's what you do. You go out and you buy some put spreads and then you sell puts. This is going to be kind of a goofy looking ratio. You want to do it. If you don't want upside risk, that's fine. Try and do it for a flat credit. So if TLRY goes to 200, then you're not out any money at expiration. Okay. But let's pull up an example. And let's just think of some numbers. I would assume that the lows from today probably could be broken. And then we will assume that, coming into about, let's just say $80 and maybe $90, the stock will slow down a bit. This is a tricky trade because if the stock goes to zero, you're hosed. What we normally see with these kinds of trades is that they will pull in, but they will find support, let's just say a previous support right here or previous support right here. Okay, so this is a bet where you say it's going to pull in, implied volatility is going to go down, but it's not going to go to zero tomorrow. All right, so this is in October. This is buying the 140, 130 put spread for about $6. Again, executions are really tough. You buy the 140, 130 put spread for $6, and you go out and you sell the 70 put for $6. That way, if TLRY goes to 200, you may be at a slight profit, and it may be at break even at expiration. Okay, your OPEX break evens are 60 and 140. So just to put some context, here's 60. And 140 is this low. So if you think TLRY within the next, let's just say 20 trading days could trade within this level, it's a good bet. Now here's the cool thing. You're probably looking at this and you're saying, well, what happens if we go to 100? I'm going to be out a lot of unrealized losses and I'm going to have to wait for the theta to kick in. That assumes that the implied volatility will stay at this level, and the bet is it won't, right? If we look at the implied volatility, it's up at 212%. What happens to this trade if, what happens if implied volatility drops 50%? 50 percentage points, okay? So we can actually model that and we can say, all right, what's gonna happen to this trade if we go from implieds of 200% to 150%? And this is what happens, where your break even will widen out from, break even started at what, 168? If implied volatility comes in, then it's all the way down at 120, and that's your T plus zero break even, right? As time decay comes in to play, that comes into play more. And what will most likely happen is that as the stock sells off, you will start to find more and more put sellers in the 70s and 60s. So that premium will actually drop faster. And what happens to this bear put spread right here is that the Vega actually goes short once you get underneath 140. So there's this beautiful kind of alignment where you can express an idea and say, you know what, this is a pretty unique situation, but we got a pretty good idea of what's going to happen here, where when TLRY eventually does pull back, and we don't know when it will, I think it's really close, the implied volatility is going to come down from 200% to 150%, maybe all the way down to 100%. And then that trade's going to be working out really well. Okay, so that's a pretty good setup to look at, I think, as a way to fade. The other way to fade is just buy the put spread straight up, and it's almost even money. Okay, so really unique situation. I think we've got some pretty good context here. We looked at the valuations. We ran some comps just to say, does it pass a sniff test? We know why it's going up. It's because everyone's trying to nail a top right here. And the options market, I think, is definitely playing a role where a lot of people are short calls and they're getting rolled over on. And now I think is a pretty good time to start looking at some trades. We will not send out any trade alerts for this simply because it does not fit the liquidity profile to ensure consistent client outcomes. Okay, so you're on your own on this. Hopefully this gave you some guidance. Start looking at short deltas on the very, very short term. Start looking at selling some ratios or buying put spreads and selling puts on it in October. And I think that those two kinds of setups are going to work out really well here.